I am Professor Catherine Espaillat. I am an astrophysicist. I study how planets form. Well, I was always interested in astronomy when I was growing up. But I also wanted to make money. So when I was an undergrad, I started off as pre-med. And then I took a few classes and I did an internship and I realized it wasn't for me. But at the same time, I was doing astronomy 101. So I was doing these pre-med classes. And I mean, the plan was to be a famous rich doctor, make lots of money and build my own telescope and use it. But then I just fell in love with the astronomy 101. And I got a little bit less interested in the medical part of things. So I just switched over to astronomy in the middle of college. Yeah, and that's how I got into it. So protoplanetary disks, you can think of them as the nurseries in which planets grow up. So when planets form, they're surrounded by these kind of pancakes. We call them protoplanetary disks, and they're made up of dust and gas. And a little bit of them is feeding onto the star, the baby star, protostar, and it's growing. And within the protoplanetary disk, dust particles in the disk are collecting, they're coagulating, they're sticking together, they get bigger and bigger, and they form planetesimals, and then they stick together, and then you get rocky planets. And then some of the rocks get so big that they keep growing and growing, and then they can get so big that they can start accrete gas from the protoplanetary disk. And that's how you get your gas giant planets. And as you know, in our own solar system and actually the other planetary systems that we see, most of the time the rocky planets are on the inside and the gaseous planets are on the outside. And that's all linked to the protoplanetary disk. So the inner parts of the protoplanetary disk are hotter because they're closer to the star. So there you can just have rocks. In the outer part of the disk, it's colder, so you can get ice. And ice is very sticky. So you get these rocks that are coated in ice. And so the icy covered rocks can stick one another more efficiently to one another. They get bigger and bigger and bigger. And that's how you can get that they get so massive that they can pull the gas in around them from the protoplanetary disk. And that's how you get the gaseous atmospheres of the gas giant planets. Yeah, so those planets are really kind of on the borderline. So they're bigger than Earth, but they're still rocky, so they're still terrestrial, so they still formed in the inner part of the protoplanetary disk. And the mini Neptunes are just smaller gas giant planets. And as of right now, they are the most populous kind of planet that we've detected so far. But that could be biased based on observational technique and how long we've been observing. So as of now, they're the most popular planet, but that could change in a few years if we get more statistics. So in the past 10 years, we've made a lot of progress in the field of protoplanetary disks. So 10 years ago, we didn't have ALMA. We didn't have, which is the interferometer in Chile, which is made up of 50 telescopes. So 50 small telescopes, and we use them together to simulate as though they're a bigger telescope. And before ALMA, we had low resolution images of protoplanetary disks. And now we have very high resolution images of protoplanetary disks. So before, we were able to see that disks had these very large kind of holes carved out in the disk, but they were very large, kind of the size of our solar system. So you have a protoplanetary disk and something the size of our solar system has been cleared out. Now with ALMA, we have enough resolution that we can see tiny, well, relatively tiny, 1 AU size gaps within protoplanetary disks. And 1 AU is the distance of Earth to the sun. And so that's very high resolution. So now before, we thought that there were very large holes in disks, and there still are, but now we're seeing that there are even smaller gaps in these protoplanetary disks. And what's really exciting is that we think that these gaps are the little kind of like the trails that the planets sweep out as they're forming in the disk, and they start to nudge out parts of the disk and they clear their own pathway. So it's very exciting because it's very hard to detect a baby planet within a protoplanetary disk because there's so much material there. The star is very bright, the disk is bright, and you're looking for this teeny tiny thing that's embedded in all this dust and gas. But we can infer that a planet is present if we look for the footprints that it leaves behind. So these little gaps that it carves out in these disks. So that I would say that's the biggest revolution in protoplanetary disks that's been so far to date. So I think one of the things that I would love for everyone to know is just how exciting and diverse this field is, studying protoplanetary disks. So when you hear about all these planet detections, these planets being detected, water worlds, lava planets, giant multiple Jupiter mass planets, super Earths, mini Neptunes, they all came from somewhere. So they all came from the protoplanetary disk. So these amazingly diverse planets came from amazingly diverse protoplanetary disks. And what I wish that everyone would know is that there are these exciting, there are these places, planetary nurseries out there in space, and that they're pretty cool to look at and study. So we have diverse planets. So we know we have to have, and we know we have to have diverse protoplanetary disks, and we see diverse protoplanetary disks. And looking for the overlap between the two is difficult because most of the statistics on exoplanets, those are detecting planets that are very close to their stars. Because the way that most planets are detected is through transit technique. So you sit there and you look at the star and you wait for it to dim. And you don't want to sit there for 20 years. So most people, you know, you sit there for a year or two to see it dimming and they say, oh, I got a planet. So most of the planets that we detect are very close to the star. And then the resolution that we have to image protoplanetary disks, we don't have that kind of resolution yet. We're still a good 20 to 30 years away from that. So we're detecting planets, these gaps that we infer in the disks, we're detecting them about 5 AU or more from the star. So 5 AU is where Jupiter is in our solar system. So we're very sensitive in the protoplanetary disks to the outer part of the disk, so Jupiter and beyond, so the gas giant planets. We don't have the resolution yet to detect the terrestrial planet forming region. So once we get to that point, and that's where the field is trying to go, build more sensitive instruments, bigger telescopes to get to that inner planet, terrestrial planet forming region, then I think we'll be able to make direct comparisons between the exoplanet statistics and the protoplanetary disk statistics. So it's kind of like a dance. So it's like you get some observations and they're exciting, they're cool, they're nice, they're new, but then you want some theory because you want to be able to explain what your observations are doing. So that involves, so I work a little bit with some codes, some simulations where you take some physical equations and you put them in your programming language, and then you input them with different parameters that you get from the observations, and then you try to reproduce the observations. So trying to connect the physics that we think we understand, so those equations, with putting some input parameters that we understand, that we measure from the observations. And then sometimes some scientists who do pure theory, they're all looking at the numbers and making these predictions. And sometimes they make predictions that we try to follow up with observations. So for example, there was a theoretical prediction that planets should clear out gaps in disks, and that came before the first observations of gaps in disks. So that kind of shows you, but then we get all these observations now of these gaps in disks, and there's a lot of gaps in disks. So now the theorists have to go and run their simulations and try to explain how do you get multiple gaps in disks. So observations and theory, it's always one, you know, a few steps ahead of the other. We're always pulling each other forward. There are a lot of mysteries. I'm trying to figure out which ones to focus on. I mean, there's a lot more that we don't know about protoplanetary disks than we do know. I think the biggest mystery right now is regarding the gaps in the disks. So we've detected a lot of gaps in protoplanetary disks, and the theoretical simulations tell us that planets should carve out gaps in these protoplanetary disks. But so far, we've only detected one baby planet within one of these gaps. So I think one of the mysteries is each of those gaps, does each of those gaps have a baby planet in it? Or could there be other mechanisms that are carving out these gaps? Or is it possible for a baby planet to clear out multiple gaps due to resonances? Resonances have to do with if you're in one orbit, you can still gravitationally interact with adjacent orbits. So perhaps one planet can clear out three gaps or four gaps. So that's something I think that we're really excited about in protoplanetary disks, trying to detect the baby planets within these gaps. It's very hard, and we've only found one so far. And it's really the search continues to search all these gaps and see if there's baby planets in there.